to just a certain extent, Lord. We can hardly scratch the surface, God. Yet in the glimpse of what we find out, Lord, in the glimpse of the things in which we discover, Lord, man, it blows our minds. And we thank you, Lord, that you are such an amazing, awesome, humongous God. And you do mighty work, stuff that we can't even fathom or see or understand, Lord. And so now, God, as we study your word and as we look at who you are, help us, God, to just consider these things and help us to understand as we long to draw closer to you, God. So use this time, Lord. May your spirit enlighten our minds, our hearts, God. Would you just anoint our pastor and just use him as a vessel, Lord, to speak through tonight, God. We thank you. We pray these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Anson. Go ahead and have a seat. Well, we're continuing our study through the things that I think we need to know, just the basic stuff of what it is we believe as people who follow Jesus and believe the Bible. So for most of us, a lot of these things are review and reminders, and for some of us, maybe it's a new introduction, but we started off the first week talking about the Bible and why we believe that the Bible is the Word of God and why we operate under the assumption that the Bible as we know it is without error. We don't approach the Bible and decide which parts of it we want to believe in. That's just too hazardous. So we believe that God inspired it all, that's what the scriptures themselves teach, and so that's our basis for truth. And everything else that we talk about is going to be based on that belief, that conviction, that we can trust this book, okay? Last week we talked about creation and how important it is to understand God as our creator, but also as we went into Genesis 3, the way that the devil was able to corrupt humans by appealing to really what happened is in Genesis 3 when the serpent came to Eve is that people who had everything they needed, God had given them everything that they could possibly desire. And what Satan did was cause them to be discontented. Here they were naked and unashamed. He caused her to believe that, wait, you're missing out. God might be ripping you off. And it's the same lie that he tells today. Every time we are less than content, it's him coming in. And every time that we become self-conscious, every time we're worried about what people think of us and things like that, it's a sign that we are taking on shame that he doesn't intend for us to have. And so we talked about how sin came in and damaged humanity and continues to work in our lives every day. Every time one of us decides that we aren't content with what God has given us or who he has made us, it just comes creeping back. That same damage, that tendency that makes us want to do things that we know are stupid, things that we know are damaging, and yet it's so easy for us to be enticed just with the outside chance that maybe this will be good. Well, tonight we're going to talk about God himself. We saw God last week as the creator, and that's important. But God is incredibly complex, as you might imagine. He's God. And so what we want to talk about tonight in particular is the fact that God is a triune being. We call that the Trinity or the triunity of God. The idea that there is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, and yet there's only one God. To be honest with you, I think most people are kind of tritheists. They actually believe that there are three separate gods because that's kind of where our brain goes. The Bible teaches that absolutely that's not the case. There is one God, but at the same time, that God is manifest in a fellowship of persons, of three personalities that function within the overall Godhead. And I'm not going to pretend that that's easy to understand. I've been studying it all of my life, and I still, once in a while, I start to think I understand it, and then I go, no? What happened? I missed it again. But I do know what the Bible teaches, and that's what we have to focus on. So the first verse of the Bible, Genesis 1:1, we looked at it last week in respect to, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. But I want to zoom in on the fact that it's God who created it. The Hebrew word there, the book starts out, you know, that in the beginning created God. God was the one who was creating. Bara Elohim. The word for God here is the word Elohim. And I normally don't want to bore you with a bunch of the original languages because it reads fine in English. But the reason I'm pointing this out is here in the very first verse of the Bible, we get a hint because that there's more than just a God. Because the Hebrew word Elohim is what we call a plural noun. In English, the plural means more than one. So if there are two, we would say that's plural. Usually the way we make a noun plural is by putting an S on the end of it. Well, in Hebrew, there are actually three cases instead of two in that way. And you have singular, you have dual, which if there are two of them, it's a dual noun. And if there are three or more, it's a plural noun. So in Hebrew, whenever you see a word that ends in im, it's a word that is in the plural. It means there are three or more. The singular, if you were going to say God in a purely singular fashion, and it does that in a lot of places in the Old Testament, it's the word El. And you've heard this a lot. A lot of the names that we refer to as names of God are just a name with El, being an aspect of God with the El tacked onto it. So you would refer to God singular as El. Now the dual in Hebrew would be Elah, and that's something that we don't see in the scriptures at all. But grammatically, it would go from El, which is singular, to Elah, which is a dual. But anytime you're going to have three or more of something, it's im on the end of it. So Elohim in Hebrew, if it wasn't God, it would be translated gods, meaning three or more. And there are places when it refers to multiple gods of the heathens, and it uses the same word, Elohim, because that means that's plural, that's three or more. So why don't we say there are three gods? Well, some people would say that, and generally what Jews would tell you who are Hebrew scholars would say some words are a plural of majesty. In other words, when you want to emphasize how great something is, you would refer to it in the plural. So that would be their response to this. All I want to say really is that it's a hint. I'm not saying that the fact that he's called Elohim is proof of the Trinity, but it certainly would catch my attention right off the bat just to begin with. But now look down in chapter 1 a little further, down to verse 26. As God is going to create people, then God, Elohim, said, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, birds of the air, the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his image, in the image of God, in the image of Elohim. He created him, male and female, he created them. So it's a whole different thing to say, what does it mean that we are created in the image of God? That somehow we are to be representatives. And an image, you know, we talk about idols as graven images, because an image is a symbol of something. In the Greek, it's icon, and we use that term all the time on a computer. An icon is something that represents a file. We use it in society to say that someone is a cultural icon, meaning they represent a whole lot. Well, to be in the image of God means that in some way you are reflecting God. Now, people have debated, what does it mean that man is created in the image of God? Some people have suggested that people, in a way, are trichotomous beings, and a lot of times in the Bible it refers to that. That is, there are kind of three aspects to us, body, soul, and spirit. And some people would indicate, and it's an interesting thought at least to consider, that by being created in the image of God, we have those aspects where, you know, I can't divide my body, soul, and spirit. But at the same time, it's amazing how complex I am, that my body can be fine, but my soul can be hurting, or that my spirit can be alienated from God, where my body and soul, my mind, will, emotion, all those kinds of things are doing fine. So that's one aspect. But also, in a more simple way, why is God saying, and who is he saying it to? Let us make man in our image. Again, does it prove the Trinity? No, it really doesn't, because people can always come up with an excuse as to why, you know, they would say, well, it's just a figure of speech. He's just speaking in some sort of metaphoric, symbolic way. It's an anthropopathism, where it's treating God as if he's a person, and so God's just talking to himself. He's, you know, because he's alone, so therefore he just speaks to himself. You can find a lot of, you know, I'm not saying that I would use the scripture to argue, but I'm just saying if you're reading the Bible and you read the first chapter, you would like, why is he called a plural noun that's three or more? And why is he having a conversation with himself? Let us make man in our image. So that's interesting. Now, the Jews will really freak out about this because they, along with Muslims, by the way, are adamant that there's one God. And Jews and Muslims both would accuse Christians of being tritheists. That by us believing in a Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that really it's hard to distinguish that from saying there are three gods. And so one of the things that the Jews are so locked in about, and if you turn over to Deuteronomy chapter 6, you'll see a passage that's called the Shema. The Shema starts out, "Hear, O Israel," and Shema is the Hebrew word for hear. So this is something that the Jews regularly recite. It's one of the most important passages of Scripture to them. And as you read, if you read this whole chapter, you discover why. Because Moses is just saying, put this on your heart, program it into your mind, be obsessed with it, hang it from your doorpost, hang it from... It's where they get the idea of hanging scriptures from their foreheads, with phylacteries and stuff. But listen to this in verse 4. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord, our Elohim, the Lord is one." And then he goes on, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, with all your strength. And I command you to do these things, do them in your heart, teach them diligently to your children. Talk about them when you're sitting around the house, when you walk by the way, when you go to sleep, when you get up in the morning, bind them as a sign on your hand and frontlets between your eyes. Write them on the doorposts of your house and your gates," and so on. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one," is the Shema. Now, that gets to the heart of why Jews have such a hard time considering the possibility of a triune God. Because they're like, no, we're not tritheists. There's one God. And so they are so strong on that. But here's an interesting thing. Verse 4, again, Deuteronomy 6. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." Now you'd think, If it's emphasizing that there is only one God, there is a Hebrew word, one, that just means one. Interesting thing here is it uses a Hebrew word, echad, which is a word that means a compound unity. For instance, when you go back, when God is first talking about marriage, that a man will leave his father and mother, cleave to his wife, and the two will become echad, one flesh. And this word in particular in Hebrew is used never to denote there is one as opposed to several. It's always talking about unity, but it is not implying at all just singularity as its emphasis. And so even in the most quoted and the most strong verse in the Bible, there's only one God. That one is like two people who are married who become one. It's an interesting choice of words, certainly, that God inspired Moses to write here. But then as you read through the Old Testament, and we can just turn over to Isaiah chapter 9. And just one of the best verses in the Bible, Isaiah 9:6. We usually cite it at Christmas. Verse 6, chapter 9, Isaiah. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God. Then the Everlasting Father, or the Father of Eternity, the one who made everything happen, and the Prince of Peace, and of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He'll sit upon the throne of David to order it and establish it and so on. So, there's one God. But how can a child be born and a son be given simultaneously, that the government would be on his shoulders, that he would sit on the throne of David, but he is the mighty God? And some people go, well, he's called God. No, that term, therefore, mighty God, is an incredibly strong term that's used, in the chapter previous and the chapter next to refer to the only God, the mighty God. It's like this is the God of gods. How can you talk about a child who will be the mighty God? You just have to scratch your head. There's no really good explanation for that. It just is what it is. But then we know, as we come to the New Testament, we studied it on Sunday morning 5 weeks ago, John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. How can the Word be with God and also be God? You could see, okay, and the Word, was in the beginning, and the Word was God. Okay, then you're like, okay, so this Logos actually is just God. But this is a Word that is with God while at the same time being God. And then John goes on to say, everything that was made by Him. If there's one thing we know from Genesis chapter 1, it was that Elohim created the heavens and the earth. It's not at all odd, except now you have someone who, later on in John chapter 1, it says the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. It becomes clear we're talking about Jesus in his state before he became a baby, before he was born, before Isaiah 9:6 describes who he was. But it's like, He's God, but he's with God. And now you begin to go, it isn't as simple as I thought it might be. Because he's with God, he's creating everything, but at the same time, he's with God. There's some kind of teamwork going on here. Now, Jesus, the New Testament is really unambiguous about the fact that Jesus was God. We saw one just last Sunday where when he called himself the Son of God, the Jews said, wait, he's making himself equal with God. And Jesus didn't say anything to discourage that. He, in fact, said, yes, I am equal with God. He, at times he said, hey, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. But he isn't the Father, and the Father isn't the Son, but somehow they are God, both of them. And not just part God, they're completely God. But we can look up a couple other verses. Go over to Colossians chapter 2 in the New Testament. And this is one of the strongest statements from Paul about who Jesus is, and specifically about the fact that he's God. Colossians 2, chapter 9, he's been talking about Jesus being superior to everything else. And he says, well, in verse 8, beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ. For in him, that is in Christ, dwells, resides, all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him who is that of all principality and power. Paul chose a word fullness, which is the Greek word pleroma, that describes the total package. When you would use the word pleroma, you would be saying, that is all that there is. It's right there. This is complete and total. So for him to say of Jesus, not just that he is God, because if you can say Jesus is God, then you can always just say, well, there must be several gods. That's sort of the path that Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Mormons, and others kind of take with it. It's like, okay, there's multiple gods. It's okay. And they would translate John 1 as the Word was a God. It was just one of gods. But you can't, and again, they mistranslate that completely on a false assumption that they were told about the Greek language, that they don't know Greek, and they botch it up completely. It's not that at all, but we don't have time to go into that. But I just say, in him dwells all the pleroma, all the whole package of God. Everything between here and God resides completely in him. And notice, it's all the fullness of the Godhead. What is a Godhead? Again, very strong Trinitarian language, very strong indication that, you know, everything that there is to God is in Jesus. That's one of the reasons why we know that it isn't just that the Father is part of God, the Son is part of God, and the Spirit is part of God. We also know that it's not just one God, like Clark Kent and Superman, that what theologically they call modalism, and that is sometimes he shows up as the Father, sometimes he shows up as the Son, and sometimes he shows up as the Holy Spirit. Real problem when Jesus is baptized by John, and Jesus is there in the water, and the Holy Spirit's descending on him like a dove, and the voice of the Father comes from heaven all at once. Whoops. They're not just the same guy wearing a different outfit. There is this unity, there is this Godhead that Paul refers to, but surprisingly lets us know, and it's important theology, that everything that there is to the Godhead is in Jesus. Now you can, by extension, you can begin to understand that also everything that there is to the Godhead is in the Father. And everything that there is to the Godhead is in the Spirit. So you're dealing with capacities and even logically challenges to your thinking that are like, I can understand somebody being a part of something, but how can I understand when they are all of something? It's really, it's difficult, but it's unambiguous because that's what it says. So I believe it even on the days when I scratch my head at it. And really, if God was so simple that we just understood him very simply, then he probably wouldn't be a God worth worshiping. He certainly couldn't be a God who dreamed us up because we are complicated. The truth is, you don't even know yourself. There's stuff going on in my head all the time that I don't know where it comes from. I tell people all the time, if you start thinking that you're mentally healthy, just think about some of the dreams that you have and realize your brain made that up. You know, that's like, well, you're complicated. People are complicated. Well, wouldn't we expect to be complicated if we're created in the image of God? But wouldn't we expect to be God more, to be more complicated than we are? And so it shouldn't surprise us. It's just very clear. And there are numerous scriptures that do it. One other one that I love is Titus 2:13, where Paul tells Titus, we are looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, there are people who, of course, all the cults who don't believe in the Trinity say, oh, it's you're waiting for our God and our Savior, two different people. But in the Greek, that's not possible. There's a rule called the Granville-Sharp rule in Greek. You don't need to know it. But the way it works is when you have two words that are separated by the conjunction. In Greek, it's the conjunction chi, but it just means and. One of them having a definite article, which we would call the, and the other one being inarticular, no definite article, they have to be referring to the same thing. So if you didn't get any of that, understand this. Titus 2:13 has to mean it's talking about the same guy, our God and Savior. The same guy. It's not two people. It's one. And so, again, in plenty of other places, as we're going through the Gospel of John on Sundays, we're seeing over and over again Jesus explaining that he's God, that he's always been here. So you have hints from the Old Testament about a plural God, a deeply rich entity that is actually a multiplicity of persons, but only one substance. And so the Godhead, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, are not, sometimes people say, they're three separate gods. You know, no, they're not. There's nothing separate about them. Jesus makes that really clear. He's like, whatever I do, the Father does. You know, you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So, but it is correct theologically to say that they are distinct because they aren't just all blurred together. The Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit are persons within a Godhead. And it's a bad analogy, but if you're married, you're two different people. But if I'm talking about a marriage, you have one marriage. A bad analogy, but at least it might help us to realize that there can be one God, because if by his definition he is an entity, he is a fellowship, he is a unity, then it shouldn't surprise us that he can be exhibited in this way. So we can look at the Old Testament and go, wow, it sounds like a compound unity. It sounds like the possibility of a plural God, that God can be not just the Father, that a Son can be born who is also God. And then we come to the New Testament, and it's just replete with references of the fact that Jesus is God. Again, Colossians 2, everything that there is to God is in Jesus. So if you have a hard time with that, join the club. But it's what the Bible teaches. It's what makes Christianity what it is. And to believe less than that is to deny a teaching that has been universally accepted throughout church history for almost 2,000 years, as this is what we believe. I'll talk later about what happens if you don't believe that, because I want to be sensitive to that. So you have a potential compound unity. You have a Jesus who is clearly God. How about the Holy Spirit? Well, there are a lot of places where the Holy Spirit is seen as distinct, but let me just turn to one for you so you see that, you know, this that the Holy Spirit is in fact God also, and not just kind of like the Spirit of God, the way that we might refer to our own spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 16. This is a verse that you're probably familiar with, but maybe you never thought of it in this way. Do you not know, verse 16, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him, for the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. Now, we're familiar with that passage in that, oh, we need to take care of our bodies. We shouldn't be abusing them because the Holy Spirit lives in our bodies. But notice what it says. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, so your body has God in it. Again, don't you know that you're the temple of God because the Holy Spirit lives in you? Now, if the Holy Spirit living in you means that God lives in you, what does that tell you about the Holy Spirit? He is clearly being represented as being God as well. So now we have Jesus clearly as God. There are other passages that talk about the Holy Spirit in a very clear way as God as well. And you certainly have God the Father. You see a relationship between them, but you know, now it starts getting like, the Father is God, the Son is God, the Spirit is God. They are together in this fellowship, each of them being God, each of them being distinct, but all of them being completely God. Your body is not the temple of part of God. It's the temple of the Holy Spirit, and thus it is God's completely. Now, there are some verses, and I'll refer to a few, that although you couldn't use any of them to argue the Trinity absolutely, you begin to realize that, you know, from Jesus onward through the New Testament, that Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are treated in a way that would be stunning and shocking were they not all God. So the first one you can turn to is Matthew 28:19. As Jesus was giving the Great Commission to his disciples after he had died, rose from the dead, and he's ready to ascend into heaven, and he is telling them what to do, to go out to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth, to go disciple all nations. And he says, go therefore, verse 19, and make, you know, first of all, he says, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore on the basis of my authority and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Or in John's gospel, he says, I'm going to be with you because the Holy Spirit, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. So when the Holy Spirit is in you, I am in you as well, even though we understand that also the Son is at the right hand of the Father interceding for us, but it doesn't matter. But again, here, how in the world do you say, I baptize you in the name, and it isn't plural. He doesn't say, baptizing them in the names of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Singular. Baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, what would I be saying if I said, I want you to go out and baptize people in the name of God and Dave Rolph? You're like, well, no, you shouldn't even, I mean, maybe I've baptized a lot of people, and it's always a blessing when I run into someone and they go, you know, you baptized me 30 years ago, and that's really special to me. It's something that means a lot just to be there and witness it. But when I baptized thousands of people, and never once did I baptize them in any name other than God's name. And so, and there are some people who, of course, there's another gospel that says baptizing them in the name of Jesus. So I kind of do, when people used to argue with Pastor Chuck about that, the last 15, 20 years of his baptizing, instead of saying, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, Chuck would say, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. And that way nobody can say, you weren't baptized in the name of Jesus. But see, it doesn't make a difference to Jesus, because there is one name that's above every name, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. It's the name of one God. And so it would be blasphemous to bunch them up in this way. But let me read you a couple others so you get the idea. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 11. As Paul is talking to the people who used to be thieves and covetous and drunkards and revilers and so on, he says, and such were some of you, but you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. Really? So it's the Lord Jesus and the Spirit and God? Again, how do you bunch those together? A little later in 1 Corinthians, over in chapter 12, in the passage on the gifts, look at what he says, beginning with verse 4, as he's talking about spiritual gifts, which you would think he'd be talking about the Holy Spirit, which he does. But look at this succession from verses 4 through verse 6. He says, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are diversities of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it's the same God who works all in all. The Spirit, the Lord Jesus, and God used side by side. It was a normal expression for them in the New Testament to bunch these three together. It was clearly their understanding early in the first century that God is a triune being, that it's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit together working in this powerful way. And just another author, Peter, over in 1 Peter, the first chapter, he flows into this also just very almost routinely. 1 Peter chapter 1, and Peter says this in his greeting in the letter. It's Peter, verse 1, an apostle of Jesus Christ to the pilgrims of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father in sanctification of the Spirit for obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. See, again, when he's talking about God, he's like the Spirit, the Father, Jesus Christ himself, using them simultaneously. You see this over and over in the New Testament. You wouldn't do that if any of them, if each of them was at all less than God. Now, turn over to John chapter 17. And John 17 is where Jesus prayed his high priestly prayer, we call it. He's about ready to go and die, and he's just pouring his heart out to the Father. And he prays not only for his disciples, but he prays for us, the people who would end up coming to faith through the word of his disciples. And beginning with verse 20 of John chapter 17, I do not pray for these alone, just the 11, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that's us, that they all may be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. And the glory which you gave me I have given them, that they may be one just as we are one. I in them and you in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them as you've loved me. That is, to me, one of the most amazing concepts in the Bible, the most amazing prayer coming from Jesus himself, to say, Father, the kind of relationship that we have, the kind of unity that we have, who we are, he says, I pray that they will have that kind of fellowship, that they will blend together where they almost begin to lose their personal identities and they understand themselves completely connected. And then he seems to envision a time when we will all be dissolved into this incredible unity where we begin to experience the kind of fellowship that Father, Son, and Holy Spirit have experienced for all times. That blows my mind. Now, there are people who would look at this and suggest that at some point, everything just becomes one big God, or that we all become members of what was a Trinity and now it's a, you know, again, you don't want to take it too far. You want to understand what he's saying here and what he isn't saying. But I think it's so important for us to see that the relationship within the Godhead is a model for the kinds of relationships that God wants us to have with each other, that God wants us to have collectively with Him. He is, and probably for all times, is ushering us in to where we participate in who He is. As John said, "Beloved, now are we the sons of God, but it hasn't yet appeared what we shall be. But we know that when He shall appear, we shall be like Him, for we will see Him as He is." And He says, "And everybody who has this hope in Him purifies himself even as He is pure," 1 John chapter 2. So the idea is His vision for us is way beyond what we could ever envision. And the closest model we have for it is a Godhead whereby Jesus says, the Father just lets me do the judging. And then He says, and everything I do is what the Father tells me to do. And everything the Holy Spirit is going to testify is going to be about me. You realize that through this Godhead, through this triune God, you defeat one of the biggest enemies that we have in life, which is egotism, which is the idea that I am just one. It's just me against the world, or it's just me and not you, or I'm trying to get something, and it's a zero-sum game where if I don't get it, you will. If you get it, I won't. Within the fellowship that's the Godhead, there is no ego at all, because they are together so much so that they're actually one God. Of course, you know, Paul makes it really clear, as Jesus does too here in John 17, He wants His people to be one. He wants us to use that model as a way for us to figure out how to connect to each other. We will never do it perfectly, and we will never be God, but there's a hope, because Jesus prayed for it for us, that we can actually somehow enter into this mystical fellowship that the Godhead so models for us and then says, come on in. We want you guys to be a part of it. Now, again, our brains aren't ready to handle that, nor are we ready to be able to really participate in that kind of a fellowship. Somebody would mess it up, for sure. But it's a model. But we're created in His image because we are created with the need to connect. We are people who it is, as the first thing that God created that He said wasn't good was, it's not good for a person to be alone. I want to match them up with somebody. And that's when you read like 1 Corinthians 12, as Paul talks about the body of Christ and the gifts of the Spirit. And later on another night, we'll talk about the Holy Spirit and spiritual gifts and things like that. But it's like, that is a picture of this perfect unity, of this perfect fellowship, where it's like, if it happens to you, I'm happy. And it's one of the things where if I begin to judge life based on whether I had a good day, and instead I lose sight of the fact that somebody who is a part of the body of Christ had a good day today, and therefore that's a good day for me. Every time I hear of someone who's hurting or somebody who's going through a difficult time, I hurt with them. But at the same time, I need to listen and realize there are people who had a great day today. I might feel a little under the weather, but there are people who feel great. And we're all connected. When we become dissolved into this unity that God models for us, it's more than just a theological concept for us to grasp, but it's actually where He wants us to be headed. It's what Jesus is actually asking the Father, that we would begin to experience a similar kind of connection, and that apparently the more that we experience that loss of ego and that blending together, realizing we are all a part of His body, then in some kind of way that I don't understand, we become immersed into the very fellowship that makes God who and what He is, this triune being. And that's why, for me, the Trinity is not just a theological concept that, okay, wow, I understand God, he's really, it's amazing who He is, and I get it down. three distinct personalities, one God, one, you know, three persons, one God. I can understand that, but the real point of it is, it's speaking to us as our minds are blown by the reality of this triune God that we only can begin to understand. He's saying, and this is a model for you. This is the way I want you to live your lives. In fact, I'm praying for you to experience less ego, less it's all about me, and more about us. Because as you begin to experience that, people are going to look at you and they're going to know something about me. When they see that you can function apart from ego, then they can begin to discover the sort of relationship that they can have with God. Because as we see that work in our lives, we have a graphic representation of who God is. Now, historically, the concept of the Trinity was problematic. There are a lot of churches and religions today that don't believe in the Trinity. I don't get on them too hard about it because I do think it's a difficult concept to completely grasp. So if I can say, man, I've studied it all my life, and I can state the doctrine correctly, but it's still like, whoa, the math messes me up. And every time people try to explain the Trinity, like, it's like an egg, it's a shell, it's a white, it's a yolk. No, because the yolk is not the shell. You know, so it's really not like that. And then people will say, well, it's like water. You know, you heat it up and it turns into steam. You cool it off, it turns into water. You freeze it and it turns into ice. No, that would be what we call modalism, that sometimes God is a vapor and sometimes he is a liquid and sometimes he is a solid. No, the Godhead, each member being distinct and yet all one. I don't think we have a great... I heard Anthony Evans recently speaking over at Calvary Costa Mesa, and he used the example. He said, it's like a pretzel. You bend it around and there's three holes, but it's one, you know, okay. But really, there's nothing that comes close to it. So as a result, I'm not quick to judge people for not understanding it. But a couple of the major heresies that were branded as heresies early in the church, one of them was called Arianism, a guy named Arius, who taught that Jesus actually at one point was made into God. He was created, and you find scriptures where it's he was called, you know, the firstborn of creation, and so, and that's a whole other subject that we'll have to talk about sometime. Jesus was never created because it says everything that was created by him, so therefore he couldn't have created himself. But Arianism said that he became the Son of God and he developed into that. And the church in 325 BC at the Council of Nicaea, the Nicene Creed makes it very clear about Jesus. He is God of gods. He's Lord of lords. No, he is everything that there is to God. He's nothing less than the Father. And then they went ahead also in the Nicene Creed and declared that the Holy Spirit is also being generated from the Father. And then a little later, the Western Church included and from the Son. Again, as soon as you start trying to explain the Trinity too much, you get into trouble. But church history would say it's not that Jesus became God, it's that he was always God. And then, like I mentioned earlier, modalism keeps coming back in different forms. A lot of the people who deny Trinitarianism today would have some form, whether it's Jehovah's Witnesses. Mormons have a little different take on it. There are some Church of Christ and other churches who basically have a modalism. They go, yeah, I believe Jesus is God. I believe the Father is God and the Spirit is God. But I think it's just one God, and sometimes he manifests himself as a Father, as a Son, as a Spirit, as we talked about before. It's not that, because then there would be no fellowship in the Godhead. How could Jesus say that they would have the kind of intimacy that we have if they don't have any intimacy? All they have is three outfits hanging in their closet that they put on at different times in order to be different things. So modalism is also heresy. But, you know, one of the most important questions would be, can somebody be saved and not believe in the Trinity? And, there are people who would say, if you don't believe in the Trinity, you are not a Christian. If a church doesn't believe in the Trinity, they are a non-Christian cult or a sect. I'd want to be real careful with that. I don't like defining who's a Christian and who isn't. I would say if a church doesn't believe in the triunity of God, that they're wrong about that, but I'd be hesitant to say that they aren't Christians. For instance, the thief on the cross. He doesn't know much. He sees Jesus hanging on the cross. He says, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom," and Jesus says, "This day you will be with me in paradise." Do you really think that thief instantly understood the triune nature of God? I don't think so. Probably didn't even understand completely that Jesus was God. All he knew is he wanted Jesus and he followed him. When Paul said to the Philippian jailer who was freaking out, and saying, "What must I do to be saved?" "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved." Well, was he saved by believing in the Lord Jesus Christ? I would submit that he was. Now, maybe later he came to understand the nature of the Trinity, the problem of evil, the nature of creation and the fall. Who knows? But he was saved because he put his faith in Jesus Christ. And we will have one night sometime in the future when we talk about salvation. What does it actually mean? But I just want to say this, that you don't become saved by believing in the Trinity. And you don't become not a Christian because you're like, "I don't know, I have problems with the Trinity." It's okay. The Trinity doesn't have a problem with you. God knows you and he loves you. And if you name the name of Jesus and cry out to him, you're saved. It's just that you're wrong. And you're wrong about a lot of stuff, and so am I. But let's not make unnecessary divisions. When I say the Trinity is an essential doctrine, I think it's important and central to understanding the scriptures and what the Bible teaches. But I personally, and you can have a different conclusion, there are different times when I have, but I personally don't want to say that if you don't believe in the Trinity, then, you're not saved. There are some people who say, "Well, the Bible never uses the word Trinity." Obviously, as we saw today, it doesn't use the word Trinity, but man, it's all through the Bible, the idea of this. And so I don't have doubts at all about the Trinity. I'm absolutely convicted that this is correct to the extent that I'm capable of understanding it. But let's not make unnecessary divisions and say, because you may have friends, maybe some of you here, you're like, "I don't know if I'm Trinitarian or not." That's okay. If you've put your faith in Jesus Christ, someday you'll meet the Trinity and it'll start making sense to you. But we don't want to exclude somebody just on the basis of the fact that they aren't sure about one of the most complicated and difficult doctrines in the Bible. Okay? Let's pray. God, you know how hard it is for us to even talk to you. We get mixed up. All of a sudden we're "Dear Jesus" and "Holy Spirit" and "Our Father." And you're just so big. You're so amazing. But as we discover more and more about you and realize that it's your intention for us to discover more about ourselves and each other and our church, we just submit ourselves to you, our great triune God. And we thank you for being who you are, bigger than us. Help us to not just begin to understand this difficult doctrine, but help us to begin to live this amazing fellowship. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you guys, thanks for coming, and God bless you. I'll see you next week.